Today we will study about Petromyzon, a vertebrate organism that belongs to the division Agnatha and class Cyclostomata. Petromyzon is also called as the sea lamprey, which is a marine form, which is lives as an ectoparasite on fishes. As you can see here, it is having an eel-like body, which is cylindrical, with a distinct head, trunk and tail. The head and trunk are cylindrical, whereas the tail is laterally compressed, that is side to side flattening can be seen, whereas the other parts of the body are cylindrical. Now we come to the fin system. You can see an anterior dorsal fin, a posterior dorsal fin and a caudal fin. So it possesses a median fin system, but like fishes, there are no pectoral fins or pelvic fins, which means that lateral fin system is absent, but it has got median fin system. But this median fin system is only poorly developed, with two stumpy dorsal fins and a caudal fin. Coming to the external morphology, the mouth, it is a cyclostome, so it has got a circular mouth in which jaws are absent, and at the anterior region of the body, there is a basin like downwardly directed depression. This is called as the buccal funnel or the sucker. So here also you can see, in this view also, this is the sucker region. So this is a basin like region, it is downwardly directed, and the buccal funnel is surrounded by a membrane, this marginal membrane, which has got a number of sensory structures, sensory projections, which are called as the cirri, and a number of oral fimbriae, which will help in food collection. So the cirri and are sensory, which is seen on this marginal membrane, and the oral fimbriae help in food collection. They are all seen on this marginal membrane, which is surrounding the buccal funnel. Now, and here you can see a number of, in this region, you can see a number of horny teeth. These are the teeth, they are all held on cartilaginous plates. So at the inner side of the funnel, you can see a number of horny teeth arising from cartilaginous plates, and they are radially arranged in rows. And the teeth are mesodermal, they originate from the mesoderm, but in other vertebrates, the teeth are ectodermal. In lampreys, the peculiarity is that the teeth are mesodermal. Now, from the bottom of this funnel, you can see a tongue. This is a rasping tongue, which is armed with large horny teeth. So the tongue is also used for rasping. It is projecting from the bottom of the buccal funnel. And just above the tongue, we can see the narrow mouth. Now coming to the head region. The head region bears eyes, which are paired. They are large and lidless, and it is covered by transparent skin. There are no eyelids, the eyes are just covered by transparent skin. So they are paired and lateral. In this view, you can see the two eyes. This is a dorsal view. And the peculiarity in Petromyzon is that it has got a nostril at the dorsal side. The nostril is single, unlike other vertebrates where there are paired nostrils. Whereas in Petromyzon, the nostril is single. It is a median nostril. As you can see here, this is the nasal aperture. This condition is said to be monorine. Now on the head, there are many pores which open to a system inside the body, which is called as a lateral line system. This lateral line system is used for sensing vibrations in the surrounding seawater. So they can be considered to be sense organs, and the pores of the lateral line system are also numerously distributed on the head region. Now, you can see the external gill slits. There are 7 pairs of external gill slits behind the eyes. So 7 on the other side and 7 on this side. This is another feature you can see in a Petromyzon. The number of gill slits is fixed, that is 7 pairs. Coming to the anus. The anus is located in the mid-ventral region. It is seen between the trunk and the tail. So this is the tail and this is the trunk, where you can see at the in between them is the anal opening. And the digestive waste are discharged out through the anal opening. And just behind the anus, there is a urinary papilla. And it is through this, and at the end of this urinary papilla is a urogenital opening through which the gametes as well as urine is discharged out. The skin is smooth and heavily pigmented. There are no scales. Then there is no exoskeleton. That means scales are absent. The endoskeleton is cartilaginous. Bones are totally absent. So this is the cartilaginous endoskeleton. No bones, and there is a persistent notochord. The notochord in the embryonic stage is persistent in the adult. The muscles of the trunk and tail are arranged as paired series, and these paired series of muscles are called as myotomes. They have got a, coming to the digestive system, they have got a straight and uncoiled alimentary canal which starts from the mouth, which leads to the so this is the tongue region, and here there is the buccal cavity. This is the buccal cavity, and then part after the buccal cavity is the pharynx, and then it has to continue as the esophagus. But there is a peculiarity in Petromycin. Here, this is the buccal cavity which leads to the pharynx. So this is the pharynx, but the pharynx is blindly ending. It is like a blindly ending tube, and the buccal cavity here, it leads to the esophagus. So this is the esophagus and this is the pharynx. But in other vertebrates, what you can see, after the buccal cavity there will be the pharynx. Pharynx will lead to the esophagus and esophagus will lead to the stomach. But here you can see that the pharynx is like a diverticulum, so, and it is also blindly ending. So this is a feature which is not seen in any other vertebrate, and this pharynx acts as a separate respiratory tube. But when you take the case of fishes, the mouth leads to the buccal cavity which leads to the pharynx. Pharynx opens to the esophagus, so the water current coming in will carry both food and oxygen. So it is common, whereas here the pharynx acts as a separate respiratory tube, which is a unique feature of this group which is not seen in any other vertebrate. And this is the esophagus. Esophagus leads to a small chamber which cannot be called as a stomach. Then it goes to the intestine. So we can say a true stomach is absent. But once we come to the intestine, in intestine, it has got the wall of the intestine has got foldings, longitudinal folding, and this longitudinal folding is called as a typhlosol, and this typhlosol increases the surface area of absorption, just like there are villi or valves in higher vertebrates. In the intestine of Petromycin, there is a typhlosol which will increase the surface area. Then it has got a liver, which is the digestive gland, which is large and non-lobular, which is connected to the digestive system. Now coming to the respiratory system. The respiratory system consists of 7 pairs of branchial pouches. You can see the 7 pairs of branchial pouches here, which lead out from the pharynx. So this is the pharynx. This is the pharynx, which I told you, which acts as a respiratory tube. And on the sides of the pharynx, there are perforations which can be called as the internal gill slits. And these internal gill slits lead to the branchial pouches or the pharyngeal pouches or the gill pouches, and the gill pouches open to the exterior through external gill slits. So the water comes in through the buccal cavity, it reaches the pharynx. From the pharynx, the water enters into the gill pouches through the internal gill slits. These are the internal gill slits, and from there it goes out to the exterior through the external gill slits. Now coming to each gill pouch. The gill pouch is a biconvex structure, and they are separated by interbranchial septa. So these are the interbranchial septa in between the gill pouches, and these interbranchial septa, they contain gill lamellae. So here you can see the gill lamellae. The plate like gills can be seen here. So these are the lamellar gills, and when water passes through these pouches, the gill lamellae will be bathed in water. And the gills, which are richly supplied with blood capillaries, when water passes through these spaces, the water will wash the gills, and there will be exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide between water and the blood capillaries contained in the gills. The gills are supported by, or the gill region is supported by, a skeleton which is called as the branchial skeleton, which consists of 9 pairs of branchial arches. Usually, as I already told you, the respiratory water passes in through the mouth and it enters the pharynx and exits through the gill slits. But when it is feeding or when it is in attached condition, the water will enter and exit through the gill slits. The circulatory system. Circulatory system is closed with an S-shaped heart, which is two-chambered, protected inside a pericardium. And this is the atrium and this is the ventricle, and there is a small chamber wedged in between the atrium and the ventricle, and that is called as the sinus venosus. It can also be considered as a third chamber. So the heart has atrium, ventricle and a sinus venosus wedged between the auricle and the ventricle. The arterial system, venous system and hepatic portal system are present, whereas the renal portal system is absent. The RBCs are nucleated, and the RBCs contain hemoglobin, which helps in oxygen transport. Coming to the excretory system, the excretory organs are kidneys, which are mesonephric. So what are mesonephric kidneys? We will just have a look at the excretory tubules present in an embryo. The anterior tubules can be called as the pronephric tubules. The middle tubules can be called as the mesonephric tubules. So, in an organism with a mesonephric kidney, during development, the pronephric tubules will disappear and the mesonephric tubules will get organized to form their adult functional kidney. So, such a kidney is said to be mesonephric. So, lampreys are having mesonephric kidneys, which consists of nephrons or urinary tubules. The kidneys lead to urinary ducts, and which leads to a urinogenital sinus, which opens out through the urinogenital papilla, and the aperture is called as urinogenital aperture. As already mentioned, the urinogenital papilla is located just behind the anus. The urinogenital sinus communicates with the coelom or the body cavity by a pair of gonopores. Now, the brain has three regions: the forebrain or the prosencephalon, the midbrain or the mesencephalon, and the hindbrain or the rhombencephalon. Arising from the brain are 10 pairs of cranial nerves. From the spinal cord, spinal nerves arise. The number can vary. The sense organs are, first one, the lateral eyes, which help in vision. The internal ears, which consist of a membranous labyrinth, which consists of utricular, sacculus and semicircular canals. They help in maintaining equilibrium. They have got an olfactory organ, which helps in olfaction or getting the sense of smell. Then they have got a pineal apparatus, which can be called as the pineal eye or the third eye, which is connected to a parapineal body, and this is said to be photosensitive. So this is a unique feature. Then they have got the lateral line sense organs, which help in detecting vibrations in the surrounding water. So the sense organs are the pineal apparatus, which is photosensitive, the lateral eyes, which are also photosensitive, internal ears, which help in maintaining equilibrium, the lateral line organs, which help in maintaining equilibrium by detecting vibrations in the surrounding water, and the olfactory organs, which help in detecting the sense of smell. Coming to the reproduction, they are dioecious, that means the sexes are separate. In larval stages, they are hermaphrodite, but later they differentiate into males and females. So, adults are dioecious with separate males and females. The males have testis, the females have ovary, they are unpaired. So, they have unpaired sex organs, and the sex organs are not having gonoducts. That means the testis lack a sperm duct and the ovary lack oviduct. So, how are the gametes discharged? So, the testis or the ovary produce sperms or ova. They are released to the body cavity or the coelom. From the coelom, through the openings called as gonopores, the gametes enter into the urinogenital sinus, and from the urinogenital sinus, the sperms or ova come out through the urinogenital aperture, which is located at the tip of the urinogenital papilla, as already mentioned. That is, there are no gonoducts, so the gametes, they are directly discharged to the body cavity of the coelom. From there, these gametes get into the urinogenital sinus through the gonopoles, from there to outside. They are semelparous, which means that they breed only once in lifetime, after which they die. So that's a very important feature, semelpari, breeding only once in lifetime. They are anadromous migrants. That means, though their home grounds are the sea, during spawning, they will migrate to freshwater, like rivers, streams, etc. So such migration is called as anadromous migration, that is from sea to river. The fertilization is external. That means the gametes are released to the river water where fertilization takes place. Another feature is the presence of a larval stage, which is called as the amoecetous larva. They undergo indirect development with larval stage, and the larval stage is called as the amoecetous larva. Coming to the life process, so during the spring or early summer, the sea lampreys who have reached sexual maturity will stop feeding and they start their migration to the rivers and streams. Once they reach their spawning grounds, they construct nets over the crescent-shaped nests made of small stones and gravel, and in them they lay 30,000 to 1 lakh eggs. And after spawning, the adults die. That is why they are said to be semelparous. And next is the larval phase. Most of the fertilized eggs, they settle in amongst the gravel of the nest and they hatch in a few weeks. The young larvae will emerge from the nest and they burrow into the stream, sand and silt bottom, where they feed on algae, detritus and various small organisms. So in this phase, they are not ectoparasitic on fishes. In the larval stage, they feed on algae, detritus, various other small organisms, etc. Then, after 3 or more years, feeding as harmless larvae without ectoparasitizing on fishes, they will continue living as feeders on algae, detritus, etc. After 3 or more years, they will undergo a change which is called transformation, where they will develop eyes and a sucker-like mouth containing sharp teeth, and they start moving to the sea to begin a parasitic life, attaching to a fish by their mouth and feeding on the blood and tissues of the host. And they can spend 12 to 18 months in parasitic phase until they are sexually mature enough to reproduce, and they again start their migration back to the rivers. So semelpari is an important feature where there is breeding only once in lifetime, and anadromous migration, that is migration from the sea to the river. So these are some of the points we have to see about Petromycin.